fans, and welcome to another exciting episode of Rip It Off The Card. How cool is this? It's another exciting Wednesday night, and we are back talking about collectibles and all the rest of it. Ange has already joined us, which is absolutely fantastic. We've got four people here already, which is outstanding. And, of course, we also have to welcome both our Facebook and YouTube viewers who are watching this on replay. I tell you what, unlike a good bottle of wine, we don't necessarily get better with age or repeat viewings, but hey, if you're still enjoying it, that's the most important thing. Now, of course, I'm not here by myself. I'm here with one of the coolest dudes in the entire universe, and I don't mean my own reflection. I'm talking about Mr. Aron. How you going, old son?
Good, mate. Look, what are we, 30 or 40 episodes in? It looks like we're not going away.
You'd have to take that zero off, I think, so there you go. All right, so we've got a big show for you tonight. If you're a Doctor Who fan, you're going to go off your nut with what we've got later on. But before we get to that, got a couple of shout-outs first. During the week, I got contacted by a dude over in Florida in America, of all places, who, once he found out about the show, signed up and liked and followed immediately. So we'd like to say a big hello to good old Greg Cochran over in Florida at the moment. Funnily enough, right now it is 6 a.m. in Florida, and I said to him, hey, if you've got nothing better to do in the morning, because it's actually a weekday over there, it's Wednesday morning, you can come and join us and say hello and all the rest of it, but the poor bastard's at work, so he misses out. But we're just thinking of you, Mr. Greg, which is the most important thing. And secondly, last week, as you know, we had Spankin on the show. Good old Dave came along and talked about his props and his collectibles, and he was just absolutely fantastic. Well, Spankin actually came into the store, Aron's collectible store, on Saturday. And I thought when I saw him, he was waiting there to be adulated by the millions upon millions of fans who watched him in that episode and thought, mate, you are just absolutely the greatest guy in the world. But no one did. So I took over and I go, oh my God, it's Spankin. He's the greatest thing ever. Oh, yeah. We're not worthy. We're not worthy. And that was about the best he got out of it. And then I told him to bugger off. So.
Turns out he just wanted to come in and buy some collectibles.
Yes, exactly right. Which is, and he brought in Tash 2 and Little Indiana, which is absolutely fantastic. So the little happy family did a journey out. You don't go to the picnics, you don't go to the beach, you go to Aron's collectibles. If there you go, kids. If you're taking a girl on for a date, that's where you go. So there you go. Very good. Now, Aron, I understand from you that you've received some feedback regarding our show at your store.
Interesting week. I've had quite a few customers come in and talk about the show, which is fantastic. So I guess I can shout out to Dicko, who won't be watching this because he likes to inform me he watches the front bar and then watches this later.
Hey, if I wasn't on this show, I'd be watching the front bar. So I'm taking one for the team here, kids. So go on.
And a couple of other guys. And the feedback I've got is it doesn't go too long. We could go longer. No. My wife would not tolerate me getting home any later. Also, I've got Colin here who rang me earlier today and had a chat. So a shout out to you. It's a Doctor Who episode, but there is a tiny little bit of Star Trek content later too. So keep your
eye
out.
Very, very good. One thing we don't want to do when it comes to talk about this show is adding in extra length, because that just has a whole lot of bad commentations. We do not want to touch. So there you go. And by the way, Thomas has said Spankin was awesome. We're going back to his real name now, Spankin, not Hankin. So which is kind of, even you spelled his name wrong. Hankins. There's no S at the end. So there you go.
Very good. Rob also is one of the Rob Bubo there is one of the customers that came in and give us some feedback. So good to see everyone on board tonight. Strap yourself in. It's going to be a roller coaster.
Very good. We've got 9 people watching us at the moment. We had 10. Someone's already buggered off, so they've just decided to leave us. So here you go. Anyway, we can't sit and lay about. We've got to get straight into, hang on, the number plate. Oh, there we go. So the number plate, Dalek. Oh, very, oh, hang on. Oh, hang on, it should be I Love Dalek. Oh, okay. Oh, very good. So you can get the love heart now for those who don't know. So you can actually put I Love whatever. I originally wanted I Love Sci-Fi, but I think someone stole that. But yeah, I don't know who's got one Dalek. So, but is it any cooler than just having Dalek by itself? There you go.
I haven't seen Dalek. I've seen Davros, and I know who has TARDIS. So there's a few of them around.
So. Yeah. No, exactly right. So there you go. Very cool. All right. So no mucking about. We've got to get into a little bit of news. So as always, we're off and running, and let's go for it.
Yeah. So this happened earlier in the week or late last week. I think we discussed how the first appearance of Spider-Man was the most expensive comic ever. Not anymore. Superman is back on top. It went for $3.25 million, which is about four and a half and change in Australian. So that would be one would be nice to find in the op shop when you're going through a box of comics. You have to point out though, that's graded 8.5, which is like really high for even a new comic you find in the shops at the moment. So to find one that's that old in that condition, it's got to be one of the top condition ones left in the world.
Is the 3.25 in American dollars?
That is in American, so it's about 4.5 Australian.
Holy guacamole, look at that. And I've just got to, prior to kicking off, I like what Daniel said. He's got an alcoholic beverage to get him through the show. Guess what? We've got alcoholic beverages here to get us through the show. So you're not on your own. So there you go. Fidel, do I ever change my clothes? I wear the same shirt every week. Well, you say, unlike Aron, who runs a store and has got all this really, really cool stuff, I'm an impoverished dude. I got nothing. Right, this is my ultra rare Hawaiian shirt collectible. So there you go. So
if you want to make that shirt instantly cooler, it looks like the Battle of Scarif from Rogue One from above. So I always imagine AT-ATs, and there you go. Now it's an even cooler shirt.
Dude, AT-ATs, get it right. In fact, they're not even AT-ATs. Just hang on, I need to put my nerd hat on there. AT-ACTs. Oh, yeah. Anyway, so yes, Fidel, if you want to know, I actually have 10 copies of this shirt, and I have them all lined up in the rack, and I just pull up the next one for the next episode. So how good is that? So I'm a bit tragic in that regard. Anyway, we move on.
Well, there's been the third-party version of this for a while, but Hasbro's finally got on board of making the self-transforming Transformers. So there's been a video going around online that you might have seen, but you can pre-order this now. It's Optimus Prime that you push a button and he transforms himself. Now, I don't know if that's so incredibly cool that you've got to get one, or it takes all the fun out of Transformers where they kind of do it themselves. But it isn't a cheap item. It's about $600.
The thing I find, and if you're, a lot of people didn't watch our show from last year, but we actually found that I think it was in Korea, they actually got a real life, you can get a video of this BMW M3, a red one, and that actually transforms into a transformer for real, right? Yeah. So it doesn't walk into anything, but it actually does. The whole thing, you can look it up on the internet, an actual one-to-one scale transformer from a real BMW that actually drives around. So who needs an Optimus Prime truck? That's boring. So there you go. What do you reckon?
Can it transform with a person inside, or do they get all mangled?
Yeah, exactly right. So, but otherwise, yes, that is actually very, very groovy.
And the other local news, I guess anyone who's into collecting retro gaming or just likes to check out the latest in gaming, PAX, which is the Penny Arcade Expo, is in Melbourne every year. There's PAX in American PAX in Melbourne. So there's not a lot of this show, and it's a big event now. They didn't have it last year because of the lockdowns and the pandemic. And because of that, the demand for this show has been huge. In fact, for a computing event, it's funny because you would think they'd be able to set up a ticketing system that wouldn't crash as soon as it went live. So they put it up live, and of course it crashed straight away, and it's not been for sale for about 2 weeks. And then they got it up and going again, and it sold out 80% almost straight away.
Now, did they get the blue screen of death when it crashed? That's what I want to hear.
I didn't see it. We tried to get it. We just couldn't get on. I go because they have lovely retro collectibles. They have a real sort of pinball arcade where everything's set to free play. Then they have all the retro gaming. Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, sorry. Finish what you were saying. I just got to jump in with something. Yep, go for it.
They have all the retro gaming, so you can go and see all the different Nintendos from different eras and Atari and stuff like that. I go with my son because he doesn't like any of the stuff I like. He likes all the new stuff. He likes to go and see all the streaming things that are sort of coming out and all the new games that they have trials of that you can test out, and they're doing sort of the trials to see how they go down with an audience. So if you're in Melbourne, it's a good event that you might not have seen if you haven't been keeping an eye out for it.
Now, I've just probably upset Aron because he's actually got photographs that he was referring to, and I'm just going to get to those in a sec. Thanks, Joe. He's got the link. So if you want to see the BMW Transformer, you almost need to put it in fast forward because it does go pretty slowly, but it's a real car that actually transforms into a Transformer, so you need to check that out. And, yes, it does actually drive, so I don't know how well it drives. I mean, they only drive it a little bit before they transform it, but it does actually do it. So there you go. There we go. There's actually more PAXes, as Sarah said. There's east, west, south. There's PAXes everywhere. My God. Yeah, pack on a PAX. There's stacks of them.
It's like
you actually might have missed one. Oh, there you go. Sarah, mate, not good enough.
there's like the Wicked Witch of the east and the north and the south and the west. There's a PAX for every witch.
Yeah, and I have to think that unless you've been hiding under a rock, you must have heard of PAX. And Angie's correct. They do all sorts of gaming, not just computer gaming, so including board and all the rest of it. So there you go. And if I'm spanking, the old stuff is better. That's why he likes me. Oh, yeah, mate. I'll tell you what, if you are next in a few weeks from now, about 3 weeks from now, I actually have my next birthday. So if you want to cut me in half and count all the rings, another ring around the trunk, as it were, feel free to do so. So there you go. And you're right, Sarah, people do travel the world to go to PAX. I remember when they first came to Australia and it was like the biggest thing in the entire universe. But I shortchanged Aron of his photos. So he didn't get the hint that he needed to just stop at this screen and not continue on. But here we go. You can reiterate what you just said, old son.
Yes, so this is PAX from 2 years ago, the last one they had in Melbourne. And there's my son playing the pinball machines with the sort of, why am I doing this? There's like real gaming going on somewhere else in this this place. And then there was Nintendo. Always have a great presence at all the PAX, and they always have a lot of special things going on. One of the things that people collect from PAX are the metal pins, the badges. And Nintendo had a hunt where if you went around and found all the different Nintendo Zelda instruments and then took it to the Nintendo booth, they would give you a metal pin. And it's interesting to see people who've been for years and years and years because they wear all their pins, and so they become more bedazzled and more bedazzled and more bedazzled every time they go. So here's just the layout of some of the other classic gaming things you can see at PAX. So you can see it's quite a large event and there's quite a diverse amount of gaming going on. And most of it is free until you want to have to buy something to take home. Then they whack you up for whatever. Also at PAX, and a lot of people don't know this, EB Games and Icon, which is Pop Culture, they often have a large presence there, a large stall. And a lot of their stuff is super cheap, especially on the last day where they don't want to take it back with them. Often they'll be throwing out pop vinyls for like $3 or $4 each, and a lot of the statues and things that are full price for most of the event get slashed down to half. So I'm not paid by PAX. I actually go and buy a lot of stuff there, but it's a good place for collectors if you're looking for something a bit different.
One of the other things they throw out are gamers who've been there since the day the thing opened, and they haven't left the entire like 50 hours or 60 hours, and they've said, all right, time to chuck them out. It's about time you swung this back into the collectible stuff, because I thought, we're talking about all the gaming. That's all great and wonderful, but we're a collectible show, not a gaming show, so let's get back into some real stuff. Hey?
I have been a couple of times where you walk past different booths and there's free play and you go by hour after hour and the same person is sitting in the same spot playing the same game. And I do wonder if they have to sort of peel themselves out of the chair at the end of the day because they've been there and they've kind of sweated into it.
If you've ever been to a sci-fi convention, the traditional one, the traditional ones from way back when, people hanging out in the video rooms for days on end was considered to be the normal thing, which was kind of groovy. So there you go, especially when you had 24-hour video programs. Oh, yeah, party time central. Speaking of party, let's get into some serious stuff. All right, so we're eBaying. What are we talking about tonight?
Tonight, I thought we would do something totally in theme with the rest of the show, Lego.
Very good. So now, we're going to go on. Anything else you want to say before we move on?
Sorry, we're going to be going and looking at different Lego. Lego is, I read an article once where the Wall Street Journal rated the best investments from property and shares and comic books and all that kind of thing. And Lego that year was number one. So we'll have a look at eBay and see why Lego is considered a good investment.
Now, if you want to find out why life in my house is so tough, I'm just going to show you this. My cat is right there. Hello, puss. So there you go. That's my ultra rare collectible for anybody who's interested. So anyway, she's just woken up and decided to give me a
rip it off. The card has now done a cat video. That means we're going to get double the views for this episode.
Very good stuff. Now, for those who haven't done this before, we're going to be showing you some eBay items that have already sold. You need to put your guesses in as to what you think they sold for. Okay, so there we go. All right, so yes, Fluffy, I know. Oh, you mean the cat? Oh, yes, absolutely. So there you go. All right, let's get into it. So let's kick it off.
Okay, this is actually a really nostalgic piece for me, because when I was growing up, we would get space Lego. And the general space Lego was about $2 for a little set, which was basically a man and half a dozen bricks to make like a little buggy or something like this. And this was my saving up and the first big ship that I ever bought, which is a one-man spaceship from 1979. This one's unusual because it's new sealed. And Lego is one of those things, the old stuff doesn't turn up new and sealed, because who back then put Lego aside? It really was to be ripped open and played with. I think even Daggers will agree with me on that.
Yeah, I remember when this set, or this series first came out, three, 4 decades ago now. And because prior to that, it was just all mainly like basic buildings and the cities and whatever. Then they started doing the space stuff, and it was really, really cool. You do the moon bases and the ships and the cars and all the rest of it. And the thing that really pushed my buttons is I like the fact that the characters had helmets with visors that would come down. And it just looks so spunky. I never owned any of it, but at the time I thought it was absolutely fantastic and really loved it. So,
I covered it in a lot of friends' collection. I think this will happen for a lot of people who collected space Lego or just Lego, that you would have your one or two pieces and you would really love them and play with them and wish you had more and there was no way to get them. And then you'd go over to your friend's place, who'd open their bedroom, and they'd have the entire lunar surface laid out on their bedroom floor and nonchalantly go, oh, yeah, I've got a bit of Lego. I don't play with it that much. You know, and your eyes bulge out of your head. So,
for those people who did actually watch our show last year, Talk Nerdy to Me, if you ever saw the logo with the ship that goes around the word, you could almost argue it was inspired by the ship with the trail that goes behind the planet. Anyway, let's move on. Otherwise, we'll never get this job done. So, Angus said $50 for this. Daniel's gone for $400. Fidel has gone for $300. Spankin has gone for $600. The numbers are going up. Joshua has gone for $750. It's still going up. Joe's very clever. Sealed $1,500. Thank you very much. Yes, that's actually probably not a bad call, considering that it is still sealed. And as Colin said, you don't get a lot of sealed stuff anymore. $550 from Mr. Colin. Good to see Colin joining us again. $350 from Phil. $250 from William. What if it is? That's too much. And what about it? $775. Oh, Thomas, you're not very optimistic, mate. $75. You're going for the cheap. Rob's at $250. Kelvin's at $300. And MPS, who's definitely the Lego dude amongst all the dudes that I know in terms of Lego dutiness, $990, just $10 shy of $1,000. So what do you reckon? Lego one-man spaceship, 1979. Holy guacamole, jeepers creepers. That's only a couple of years before you after you were born. Is that right, Mr. Aron?
73.
The price of this was sold at for a whopping nearly $2,000. I think I know who's got this. Oh, God, there's so many here, I can't find it. I think Joe's got this at actually $1,500.
Yeah, that was 1981. It's a good year, almost 1982, that price, isn't it? So,
hang on, it's 1979. Where are you getting 81 from?
The price, Dags, the price.
Oh, I'm sorry, 1981. Well, you should have added in the 98 cents then. So there you go. So how's that? $2,000. And I agree with you. If it's sealed, never been opened, that can make all the difference. In fact, someone came into the store on Saturday who apparently had a large collection of vintage Lego still in boxes. And I thought, dude, you could buy yourself another house with all that if it's never been opened, which is very, very groovy. But
Lego is one of those interesting things where the newer franchise stuff, so when Lego started doing Star Wars and Lord of the Rings, people got it and put it away, but that old stuff never turns up boxed, very hard to find.
True, and I agree, Fidel, that is insane considering it's just Lego and you could probably buy all the pieces individually really, really cheap, but, yeah, you get the box, yeah, you miss it. And funnily enough, and you're right, Phil, the Doctor Who Club of Victoria started in 1979, and we're talking about Doctor Who later on, so you're just going to have to sit tight for a few minutes. So very, very cool. All right, next one along.
Okay, we're moving forward a few years. This is from the Pirates of the Caribbean, and it's the Queen Anne's Revenge. So it's a very, very cool pirate ship. And Lego were very clever when they picked their franchises, because Lego Pirates was already a thing. And so they get Pirates of the Caribbean, and they've already got a market that, you know, collects pirates. So now they can add Pirates of the Caribbean to their Lego stuff. So Pirates of the Caribbean was a very, very good franchise for Lego. It's interesting because Lego got the franchise for the Lone Ranger, which didn't really do well, but the Lego sets did well because a lot of people collected Lego Western. So how much for the Queen Anne Revenge?
Just going back to the spaceship, you're right, Spankin, you would not open it. I reckon that would be a travesty to do that now after 42 years. So, as I said, you can probably buy all the parts individually anyway, so it really is meant to be kept in some mint condition. Anyway, so Pirates of the Caribbean and Queen Anne's Revenge. Okay, so who can get revenge on these prices? All right, so anyway, sorry, we're moving ahead. Jeffro's clocked up for $1,000. Daniel's at an extra $100 on top of that. Colin's gone for 700. Ange, everybody's talking some big numbers now. Ange is at 600. MPS is at 1300. No cheapskates here tonight. Spankers is at 1100. Hang on. Kelvin is at 995. The screen's moving too quickly. William's at 800. Ange has gone for 1600. Joshua's at 1200. It'll be funny if this thing only went for $20. Fidel's at 1000. Rob is at 950. Thomas at 3,800. Holy guacamole! You could buy your own bloody ship for that.
There's a lot more.
Joe has said, 1,200. What? Yeah, man.
There's a lot more bricks in this ship than there is in that little spaceship.
Well, I like you. I'm glad you said bricks in the ship. So there you go. Nearly misinterpreted that. Sarah has said 650. And Phil has said 1,500. I'll tell you what, if this is over $1,000, I don't know who's going to be winning this one. All right, so Pirates of the Caribbean, Queen Anne's Revenge. What did it go for? The ripping massive price of? Oh, look at that. Right on the money. Someone actually did say $1,500 on the hammer. I just got to find it. Phil said $1,500. So he's won it. And who else has got it? I'm sure someone else has got it. So talk to me about it, Aron.
Yeah, so there was a few people close. That was when it originally came out, that was an expensive set. It was already about $500 when it originally came out. And there's a few different pirates ships. There's Davy Jones and there's the Silent Mary, which is the one that's sort of all the ghost ship. And they're all very, very popular, all very hard to find.
Philip did win it, so it's all yours. You got it on the hammer, old son. And so well done, Mr. Phil. Good work indeed. So, yes, it does go to show just how much these things are worth. And what would this have retailed when it first came out, do you know?
Yeah, about $500 when it originally came out. All the flagships, the Flying Dutchman, the Queen Anne's Revenge, the Silent Mary were all around $500 to $600.
All right. Now, the BNIB, I assume, what would that be? What would that mean, BNIB? Any idea?
Brand new in box.
Oh, yeah, okay. Could have just said mint in box, and they would have just been MIB. That's the standard we use here, but anyway, not to worry. How many pieces in this set? Shitloads is the answer to that question, Fidel. Very good. Okay, and he reckons you're not a spot on the Black Seas Barracuda of 1989. Oh, well, you know, what can I say? It's Queen Anne's Revenge. All right, next one along. Go for it. Oh, Trains. Oh, yay, baby. Where's Sheldon Cooper when you need him from Big Bang Theory?
Trains is another one I grew up with. This is an electric train set. So Lego did wind-up trains, and then they did electric trains. This is quite an early one, and there's a whole subsection of collectors that play to collect and build Lego trains. And I don't know if you've ever been to Brickvention in the exhibition buildings or when they've had one locally. You can see some massive train layouts, and they're very, very impressive. This is just a small little train, engine, two carriages. How much would you expect to pay? Opened, not mint in box, but it includes the box from 1980.
So I wonder how many people actually bought this back in 1980, and now they're the same people, as you said, at Brickvention with these like layouts that are bigger than real cities. So got to start somewhere, kids. That's how it works. All right, so here we go. So for a train set from 1980, all right, Ange has gone for 1,100. Thomas is at 675. Colin's at 900. Oh, shit, wrong one. Daniel's at 1,250. William has gone right upstairs with 2,000. Spankin has also gone for 2,000. MPS is at 4,000. Oi, there's some big dollars for you. Fidel is at 700. Joshua is at 500. Kelvin is at 1,800. And where are we? 1,500 for Rob. And yeah, here we go. Lego train collectors are lunatics. Sky's the limit. I suppose they are. So there you go. So very, very cool. Phil, who won the last one, is at 2,200, which is kind of cool. A lot of money, isn't it, really, when you sit and think about it? Thousands of dollars. Considering when these things first came out, they probably didn't cost that much, even by today's standards. So there you go. All right. So it is used. probably not abuse, but there you go. Very, very cool. Anyway, the answer to this is how much did this train set go for? The answer is 1,026. So go figure that. So I don't think anybody got the 26. But
that was an odd number. There was a couple of bids on that one, so it always goes for an odd number when there's more than one bidder. I just always think when I see something like that, you could probably go and buy, you know, three or four really awesome new Lego trains, build them and put them away for the future. But I guess there's a lot of people that like to collect the original stuff.
Very good. So it looks like Ange got this and he gets some change as well. So very well done, Ange. You got the first one in and you got the right answer. So good for you. So very cool stuff. All right. So we're mixing it all up. Very good. Okay. Moving right along, as I say.
Okay. This is just for one figure from the Batman movie. When the original Lego Batman movie came out, anyone who sees it will realize that in the Batcave, Batman had many, many, many different bat suits for any occasion. This is the zebra bat suit, and it was only available at San Diego Comic-Con, and they're limited to 1,500 of them. So you've got to remember, beyond Batman, there are some people that just want to get one of every Lego figure and don't collect anything else. When you are looking at Lego, generally, the price is in the figures that come with the sets. So you'll see a lot of sets, people sell off the figures and then sell the sets separately because they get more doing it that way. So this is a San Diego Comic-Con exclusive Lego Batman. How much?
Now, if you wanted to be a real shit stirrer, what you do is you put on the card somewhere, limited 2020 edition San Diego Comic-Con, and everybody's going to go, hang on, there was no San Diego Comic-Con in 2020, and they go, are you sure? Maybe there was just a small one that was in the back somewhere that was held in San Diego. 15 people turned up with masks on and all the rest of it, but they did produce this figure, ultra limited edition 2020. Do you reckon fans would go off their nut big time if they thought that was legitimate? So I reckon that'd be the ultimate shit, sir. All right, let's go. Thomas, 65 cents. Oh, Thomas, you're not very optimistic about this, are you? Daniel's gone for 150. Ange is at 800. Oh, we're talking big numbers for this, aren't we? 200. It's just one figure, guys. There you go. Fidel has said 60. MPS, who's batting zero for zero at the moment, is at 250, I think. Greg is at 500. William is at 1,200. Actually, no, I think MPS won the first one, didn't he? So Joshua is at 400. Kelvin's at 1,000. 1,000 for one figure. Can you believe it? Spankin's at 350. Phil's also at 1,000. Rob has said 950, and Sarah's gone for the ultra conservative $70. What do you reckon? Is it worth more because it's a San Diego Comic-Con exclusive, or the fact that it's still mint and packet, it's an unusual item and whatever else? So if it had nothing to do with San Diego, was produced officially by Lego, would that mean just for Lego and nothing else, would it be worth more or less? You have to wonder. So there you go. Personally, I reckon it's a bloody ugly looking thing. You know, it looks awful. The zebra stripes. I mean, what the hell is Batman doing hanging out in the tundras of freaking Africa or something? Is he? I don't get it. So there you go. We've got another one here. Matthew has said $25. So he's going for the cheap option. There you go. So we've got a real range from over 1,000 or something down to like 70 or thereabouts. Anyway, so the Zebra Batman minifigure San Diego Comic-Con absolutely limited edition went for a whopping $780.
That's pretty expensive Lego figure. It's interesting. When you went to Comic-Con, you used to be able to just queue up and get like the exclusive stuff, but so many people go for these things now. You actually have to go into a raffle. And then if you win the raffle, you can go and get your exclusive item. So these things go for big bickies. There are people that just go to buy as much as they can and resell it, like they do ultimate scalping at Comic-Con.
Ange, he's got this one again, and he's got $20 spare to go and buy himself some hot chips or something. So well done, Ange. He's batting two for two. Oh, tell you what, if anybody's watching this show, whenever you see Ange put a price up, I think you need to sort of take a leaf out of his book, add it up by an extra dollar or down by a dollar, and maybe you'll actually get the right thing. So how good is that? But, hell of a lot of money, isn't it? So insane. $800 for it. I mean, the thing I find funny is if you took this over to your friend's house, you know, your other half or whatever, and said, oh, yeah, I paid $800 for this, they'd be going, get out. So, yes, it's a bit of a hard one to justify. And you do wonder if in the future it will hold its value. So 20 years from now, will a 2019 San Diego Comic-Con Batman minifigure be worth $800 or just be like, yeah, mate, it's all just rubbish. So only because it was a couple of years ago. All right, next one up, we have this, which is our last one.
So this is probably out of the sets released just into the shops, this is probably the best investment you could have bought for the Star Wars Lego range, the Cloud City. It's always been one of the most popular sets, and it's popular for a lot of reasons. They don't do a lot of play sets. Usually they do spaceships and vehicles and things. And also, it's got a unique version of Boba Fett in. So when you're making your guesses about this, remember how popular Boba Fett is as a figure with collectors. This one includes all the minifigures and instructions, but doesn't have the box. So this one doesn't have a box. You're looking at the instructions there. So what would you think this would go for? Surely not much without the box.
Now, I love honesty. Honesty is like what makes the world a happy place. And Angus said, I've just lost him here. Angus has said he meant to say 80, not 800. So he's still got it anyway. So, Ange, mate, you're supposed to keep that one to yourself. Go, mate, I know my stuff. When it comes to Lego, mate, I am the coolest cat in town. Not fess up and say, no, I put the wrong price in. So what a classic. All right, let's move on, shall we? So remember, there is no box, even though there's a picture of a box there. So it's kind of misleading advertising when you think about it. All right, Daniel's gone for 2,000. Moneybag Sullivan will say that. Ange, all right, I hope you got your numbers right this time, Ange. He's got 2,600. Actually, Daniel's actually got this one. Oh, there you go. Depending how much it's sold for, you can end up making a few bucks out of this. Colin, $4,500. Holy guacamole. William's gone for 2,500. Fidel's at 2,800. Joshua's at 1,800. And Daniel said the Fed alone goes for 400 bucks. Oh, my God. Would that be right, Aron? You agree with that?
Yeah, I've seen it go for more 500-600 now. It's gone up.
Oh, don't say that. Moneybag Sullivan's going to be going, oh, that is awesome. He's going to be sitting there going, grouse. I'll have it on eBay before the end of the show. Where are we? Spankin has gone for 650. Thomas, 6,500. Thomas, mate, what the hell? Oh, Sarah's gone up even higher. 7,500 bucks. Holy guacamole. 5,000 over here with Rob. Kelvin is at 9,000. We'll say 2,000 round figures. MPS. Oh, he's just not happy. $120. Dude, crikey, you're the Lego dude, and you've just come in really, really cheap. Considering that the Boba Fett figure alone is worth $400, I think you're going to be not winning this one. Where are we? Philip is at $3,000. Matthew has said $475. Yes, there is no box, so keep that in mind, kitty. So maybe it will be a bit less. And Thomas has amended his to 3,800. Oh, okay. So there you go. Oh, yeah. Now that you've heard this information, that Boba Fett's worth a lot of money. So there you go. Very, very cool. And actually, Daniel, he said he apparently got rid of it. So, yes, I reckon that, yes, you probably find that that was not the smartest thing to do in the long run. So very, very cool. All right. So it's a Cloud City, all the minifigs in the instructions, but no box. So you wonder how it's going to be given to you. I mean, it's going to be given to you like, you know, when you buy a goldfish and it's in a bag. Is it just going to be like that? And then, there you go, kids. Off you go and have some fun. So you do wonder. Anyway, the end result, how much did this go for? The price is $1,825.
So that's actually quite a good price because I had one in this condition and sold it about a year ago and it went for about half of that. So this is one that's definitely been going up and up and up. And one of those quick Lego stories I have all the Star Wars Lego and I don't open any of it. And this set was so cool. It was the one set I did open and build. And I don't like put a lot of Lego aside, but I remember going into Kmart and this one was being cleared out for $80. And I stood there and go, this is a really cool set. Should I buy five or six of them? Nah.
So. There you go. Very good. Well, Joshua has walked home with this one with $1,800. You have to cough up an extra $25, Joshua, and you have to bring your own box, obviously, but it is all yours. How good is that? Absolutely fantastic. So very, very, very cool stuff. What do you reckon there, Mr. Aron?
There's a lot of money in bricks.
Tell you what, it's a bit crazy, isn't it, eh? So, yeah, so those people are going to be running out there buying all these sets today, putting them aside ready for the future when they can be worth millions of dollars.
It is one of those things. Lego, pretty much you're guaranteed once the set is discontinued, the price goes up. There's not many Lego that you can't sell for the original price. So it is a good investment, and if you pick wisely and pick popular figures, the sky's the limit.
Very good. All right, we need to move along. So we've got rid of Lego. We've got rid of our news. We're onto something that is going to be, I don't know where Greg King is. Greg King should be joining us tonight. He is the coolest Doctor Who dude around, other than Aron, obviously. And he's not here. It's disappointing because we have our feature presentation. And what's it about? It's about this. And as it turned out, Greg is actually here. So good on you, Greg. You're going to be—I bet you're going to be salivating at what we've got coming up for you very, very soon. So I didn't see you early, but it's good to know you're around. Aron, sir, over to you.
So here we go. This is our second video discussion. The first part was 2 weeks ago. That was more of a general discussion and looking at the history of VHS and rentals and Beta and all that kind of thing. This is more of a specific look on collecting Doctor Who videos, which I am a little bit of an expert and a fanatic on myself. But before we go to looking at Doctor Who videos and archiving videos, I'm looking at what I originally did, which was audio tapes. Before we could get the videos, a lot of people collected audio tapes, and I found this when I was researching tonight's episode, and it's my earliest audio tape, which was recording off air of Ark of Infinity. And I don't know if you can see the spelling there. Episode one, Ark, is spelled A-R-K. And then episode two, I got on the bandwagon and was spelling it right, because I was only about 7 or 8 at the time. And I was thinking, Ark of Infinity, is this going to be like Raiders of the Lost Ark? Or it wasn't anything like that. But for those who are old enough to remember, we taped audios before videos, and I would listen to them in bed at night and go to sleep with an episode of Doctor Who. And Ark of Infinity was a particularly perplexing one, because there are long stretches of just 80s synthesizer music, weird guns and people screaming for one of the episodes. So that was the oldest audio visual sort of record I could find of me taping Doctor Who. Go ahead.
Now, you're right. That's what fans used to have to do, is get audio recordings, because it was the only way they could actually enjoy this stuff. And depending on how your setup was, whether you had a ghetto blaster and you could actually record directly off the radio. I remember I didn't have one, and I wanted to record Captain Kremen off the radio, but I actually had to physically hold the tape deck in front of the radio and try and get a good audio that way. And of course you're trying to be quiet, but it was so funny, you're laughing through it. So every time you played the tape back, you'd be hearing yourself go, and enjoy this stuff.
I remember the same thing sitting up one. It was a New Year's Eve. ABC Radio decided to play all of Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, and I had to stay awake and change the tapes over. Just for the questions there, my favourite Doctor is Patrick Troughton, the Second Doctor.
Very cool. And
I'm actually going to mention the audio collection. If we go back to that first picture, the Doctor Who Club did have an audio library. If you go back one to the... When I found the Doctor Who Club, you could borrow like the episodes out on audio, and it was fantastic because they had recordings of missing episodes. And I was so excited until I got the first one home, and literally all you could hear was, and I've got a picture there of Patrick Troughton, and it was exciting because you could hear him playing the recorder. So out of the whole episode, I couldn't get much of the dialogue and I couldn't get much of what was happening, but I was like, oh, that's really cool. The Doctor's playing his recorder. So that's my earliest memories of like recording.
I like this comment from Sarah. You're a much cooler kid than me. She taped Play School. Sarah, he was cooler than Aron. He was cooler than everybody. So, it really is okay. I mean, the only reason why I have to concern when I'm looking at this camera is because one must not look upon the face of greatness. That's why Aron is sitting on the screen over there. So there you go. Move along.
Okay, the other thing with recording, before we get to the recording, the release of official videos, a lot of people recorded off air. So after I got a video recorder recording off air, and of course everything has been released officially, but what is most interesting where people have off air collections is the continuities, which is the announcer at the end of the episode who tells you what's coming on next, or might say a little thing about what's been in the episode. And there are two great continuities. One's made it onto Doctor Who DVDs as an extra because it's so legendary. And it was from that first picture, Inferno, where at the end of the episode, the ABC announcer comes in and says, "Will the Doctor escape from the blue man? Like, you'll have to tune in tomorrow and see." And then he plugs the ABC shop and says, "We have a wide selection of Doctor Who merchandise, but we don't have a blue man at the ABC shop," which was quite amusing. He obviously went off script and thought he had like a bit of stand-up comedian in him. But the best one, which I remember and I have on video somewhere, but I don't really think has ever come up sort of in fandom, was the end of Invisible Enemy, where you can see the nucleus of the swarm on the screen there, and the announcer just said, "Crikey, it's enough to put you off prawns forever." that was what the continuity was on the end of that episode. So even before the official tapes were being released, people were recording them, and these are some of those little fragments of history that is lost, would have been lost if it wasn't for people doing audio or video recordings way back in the 80s.
Interesting comment from Kelvin. Club's recordings came from a lot from the UK, that are ones that are often used in the basis of restoration. So, yeah, obviously back in the day, everybody was into this sort of thing. A couple of people have mentioned that they all did similar things. And there's a whole lot of comments coming through. But anyway, continue on.
Well, the club, it's interesting. The club had an audio department. I would borrow the tapes, not understand three quarters of what was on them, but still make a copy, which was a generation down from me to keep and probably not understand at a later date. So that was the very earliest things that were sort of being recorded. Now, the other thing before the official videos, we had this, which was fanzines would actually print covers for the current episodes so you could take your recordings off air, put them in a VHS shell, and then cut out the back of the fanzine and put a custom cover. So these were a couple of the ones from Doctor Who Bulletin, a fanzine that started in the 80s. And they, for a run, put different covers on the back. And it was always a dilemma for me whether I leave the magazine mint or I cut the magazine up to use the video cover. And so a couple of them I don't know what happened to it, but I cut up the two doctors because I thought that was a particularly good cover. And I think we've got a slide here of the two doctors, the Doctor Who, the official release and the fan release. And I always thought the fan release, although it's black and white, was a bit more atmospheric and better than the actual official thing.
See, that just goes to show. Sorry, go on. I keep cutting you off. Go on.
No problem at all. So I think it just shows how creative fans were back then and how much they did to sort of support the show when nothing else was around and you couldn't find this stuff officially.
Yeah, that's exactly what I was going to reiterate. Yeah, when you don't have actually something there, someone somewhere will create the gap and fill the gap in. And even today, depending if you're like buying DVDs and whatever else and you can't get official releases, people can produce their own covers. And sometimes the work that's put into them is actually really, really impressive. And that just goes to show the passion that people and fans have for this stuff. And you can imagine a lot of fans looking at this material. You know, they go to a friend's place with Doctor Who videos and they look at these covers and they go, "That's bloody awesome. Where did you get those from?" And, of course, they're produced in-house, which was very, very cool.
And, of course, that is still going on. I think we've got another slide. Some of the bigger forums have threads online where there's many, many thousands of fans who do just mock-up covers for not so much videos anymore, but DVDs and Blu-rays and box sets. So if you don't like the official versions, you can find just about any version of the artwork that will appeal to you, and you can print it out and use it. So that's been going on for 30, 40 years, from old fanzines right into the digital age. They're from Gallifrey Base, one of the bigger online forums for Doctor Who fandom.
I've just lost the comment here I was going to put up. Hang on, give me a second to see if I can find it. Oh, here we go. So, Thomas, see, there you go. You got your own fan. How good is that? So, Thomas reckons you're a bit of a cool dude, and I reckon we need to have a statue made of Aron at some point, holding onto an action figure in one hand and, you know, maybe a Doctor Who TARDIS in the other. But, yeah, it's very, very cool. All right, so that then leads us into this.
So anyone who collects Doctor Who videos will know that this was the beginning of, a 20-year collection. The BBC Home Video launched their Doctor Who range. Here's an ad here. I think they got on the bandwagon when these ads for VHS and Beta started appearing. If you missed it on BBC or ITV, see it on JVC. So it got to the point where there was enough people that had home videos that they could, video recorders and players, that they could make a commercial leap and start releasing the tapes officially. And the BBC, being maybe not the most coordinated, the Doctor Who range is probably one of the most interesting video releases ever. Being a range that went for 20 years, it started very humbly with one release, and that release was decided on by fans. In 1983, the 20th anniversary of Doctor Who, there was a big fan event in the UK at Longleat House. So over the weekend, tens of thousands of fans descended on Longleat, and they met the actors and saw special effects and watched old episodes, which at the time wasn't something you could do because there were no videos, and it was a huge success. But one of the things the BBC did at the time, they passed out a questionnaire and they asked fans, if they were going to release Doctor Who videos, what would be the Doctor Who video that they would most like to see to launch the range? And for anyone who knows this story, fans chose Tomb of the Cybermen, which the BBC couldn't do because they'd erased it. It's a 60s show and that didn't hold it in the archives. So the next, they said it's a Cyberman story. It's got four episodes. The next best thing we can do is release another four-part Cyberman episode, Revenge of the Cybermen. And this is the earliest article I can find, fan article, on what fans think of videos coming out. Now, you would think that fandom would think, this is fantastic. Finally, we can watch Doctor Who at home anytime we want, get our hands on these episodes. This is from Doctor Who Bulletin issue 4, and it's the earliest I can find on the commercial release of videos. And basically the editorial view is releasing Doctor Who in video is going to be a bad thing, because you watch Doctor Who once and you enjoy it, and then you watch it a couple of times and you start to see the bad special effects and that it's a bit shoddy. And before you know it, you're going to have watched it so many times, you're sick of the show and never, ever want to watch it again. So from within fandom, they were pushing the line that this is not going to be a success and it's not a good thing for the show. And I find this a bit funny, because the people who were writing Doctor Who Bulletin at the time had access to all the episodes and could watch them whenever they wanted anyway. So one of the things that did happen in the 80s, there was a bit of a fan elitism with their collections. And if you had this episode or you had that episode, you had a bit of status. And I kind of can see that maybe they wanted to keep it so most of the fans couldn't have these, you know, rare items that were often changing hands at crazy prices because there was no way to get them any other way.
I'm just going to break in for a second. This question, hang on. Can you sound down, please? The volume down on your speakers?
Oh, sorry.
Thank you. So do you think this is about Doctor Who videos, VHS, will ever be an investment? We'll probably answer that question at the end of the presentation, Fidel.
Yeah, we will have a look at that.
Yep, very good. Okay, so you want to move on to the next bit, which is this?
Yeah, so this was the first Doctor Who video that was released, and it was, as I mentioned, Revenge of the Cybermen. And as I said, the BBC were a bit haphazard in their releases and how they released them. And they released this one with the wrong Cyberman, the wrong logo. They edited it together into a movie, which fans didn't like, but that was something they were going to have to live with. And it was an incredible price. I think it was £49 for the sell-through one, and about $120, or £120 if you were a video library and you wanted to buy it. And this is an incredibly hard video to find, this version of it, because it was withdrawn pretty fast. and they changed it pretty quickly. So if we go to the next slide, though, it'll show how many versions of this was actually released. They released it in VHS, Beta, and V2000, Video 2000 format, which probably is the hardest version of it to find because that format died so fast, I think they would have hardly sold any of them. The VHS release had a couple of different versions. There's one with the VHS sticker on the on the spine. There's one with it printed on the spine, and there's one with no logo at all. And there's a sell-through, which is direct-to-public version, and there was a video library version. And I've had both of them, and the only difference I can discern between the sell-through and the direct-to-public is the video library version weighs about twice as much. It was obviously on a much higher-grade tape, but all of the catalogue numbers and all of the packaging is exactly the same. And so this is in a big clamshell, which is about, you know, maybe a third bigger than a regular VHS tape from the Doctor Who line. And then I haven't had a Beta version, but I did find a picture of the Beta version online, and I thought that was unusual because the cap on the top of the video is white, where as far as I know all the other Doctor Who videos have been black, and the V2000 version I could find no information on that. And I think this was the only tape that they released the V2000 format, and then the format died. If you get online, you can find V2000 videos for sale. I don't think they were released in Australia. They were released by Grundig as a way into the market for them to fight VHS and Beta, but it wasn't ever going to happen. So that was the very first tape, and this is some different versions of Revenge of the Cybermen that you could get over the years. So the first one up the top there was released in 1983, and there was such a backlash with, oh, you put the wrong Cyberman on it and all of that kind of thing. Pretty soon they released that second version, which is more of the standard format that Doctor Who videos would get after that first release. So it's not in a plastic clam, it's in like a proper VHS case. The original tape, the artwork is actually printed onto the case, so you can't take it off. Like after that one, we moved to the plastic sleeve where you could slip the cover in and out. And that was the second version, which was only released about 6 months after the first. The first version was replaced pretty quick. So that's hard to get. But next to that, I would say, is probably the hardest version of Revenge of the Cybermen to find, and also probably the rarest Doctor Who video to find, which is the Japanese version of Revenge of the Cybermen. And the Japanese version was also released pretty early on. It was released in NTSC, I'm pretty sure. And when it originally came out, I was too young to have found it. And I spent probably, 30 years looking for it, 30 or nearly 40 years, and I only found it last year. And I found it on a Japanese auction site, and I managed to get it by sort of using Google Translate and being able to bid on the item and win it. And the interesting thing, I've had a lot of people looking for this video for me in Japan. I have different friends around the world, and I've told them to look for Revenge of the Cybermen, and they never ever found anything. And when I won it, I found out why. It's because the title doesn't actually translate in Japanese to Revenge of the Cybermen. It actually translates as Counter Attack of the Cybermen, which is probably why everyone I was asking couldn't find it for me. So if you are on the hunt for this one, I'd be looking on Japanese auction sites and looking for Counter Attack of the Cybermen.
Gotta love those translation issues, don't you?
Yeah. So, and we move into, if you remember during the 80s, those first few Doctor Who videos weren't rated. There wasn't a rating system that had come into effect for videos at all at the point, but there was a lot of uproar in the UK because of, I think we'd all remember, video nasties. Video nasties were a lot of banned films at the cinema were released on video because they hadn't set up the same laws for video that was in place at the cinema. There wasn't originally the censors didn't know what to do or what the laws were, and a lot of stuff came through that, you know, was cast as video nasties, and they were around for a couple of years. But then what happened, someone committed, I think it was a rape, and then they blamed it on watching video nasties. And of course, when that happened, there was a total meltdown and a clampdown. And so Revenge of the Cybermen had been released, and there's a couple of Doctor Who stories that are a bit notorious for being maybe a little bit too adult or having a little bit too much blood or gore for kids. And of course, what did the BBC release in the middle of this video nasties controversy? Well, they changed, tried to change public perception to video tasties, which is a nice way of just changing one letter and changing the whole meaning. But this is how the BBC changed that perception, that they weren't releasing horrific things for the little kids. But the episode they released was The Brain of Morbius. Now, The Brain of Morbius has the distinction of probably being one of the, at the time, goriest episodes of Doctor Who. Doctor Who, you know, is a bit scary and behind the sofa stuff, but you don't see people getting shot and blood coming everywhere. You don't see brains in jars dropping onto the floor and things like that. But in Brain of Morbius, you do. And Brain of Morbius, they released. And because it was, well, there's a bit of a story here, but because it was gory, it was released as a 60-minute video rather than the full 100 minutes. And it didn't sell very well at all, because that's a big slab of the story gone. So it was controversial because fans didn't want to buy it because it was missing so much of the story. And then it had come out right in the middle of this video nasties time. So the BBC was seen to be bowing to censors, and they wanted to release it as a G and not do different ratings on the Doctor Who videos. Turns out none of that was actually true. When they went to get the masters, there was an hour version that had been prepared for a repeat, and there was the full version, and whoever was sent down to the archives to get the masters just picked up the wrong version. So the BBC weren't concerned about video nasties at all. There was just a mix-up, and they released the 60-minute version instead of the 100-minute version. So if you're on the lookout for Revenge of the Cybermen, check the back where it has the blurb, and if you want the original 60-minute version, which is probably the harder one to find, you can find the running times on the back, but the 100-minute version is probably the one you want to get, complete and unedited.
I like this comment from Greg. You have to turn your volume down, man. I can hear myself through my own speakers. The brain of Morbius, tasty. Yeah, exactly right. That's what you call the video, tasty. And there is a question from, and I've just lost it up here, Fidel has asked, we'll probably get this at the end of the show as well, whether you have a full set of the videos, Aron, yourself.
I do. At the end of the show, I'll go through some of the different versions and what I've actually got. But yes, I've had different versions from different countries and different editions, and I've got enough videos to sort of build a video fort. I pulled them all in to sort of do this, and my wife just rolled her eyes because there were videos everywhere. Anyway, we'll move on. The BBC didn't really get their act together. They were releasing Doctor Who videos sort of just randomly. Fans in the UK would get upset because the ABC in Australia wanted more releases, so they would release stuff before the UK. The UK versions were often hard to find and over expensive, so fans didn't think they were getting their money's worth. And then the ultimate insult, the US started releasing the videos, and some episodes turned up in the US before they were in the UK. And there was a bit of national rivalry between the US and the UK during the 80s, because what was happening, US fans had really taken off and had a lot of money, and all the big conventions were happening in the UK, and UK fans couldn't book as many actors to do UK conventions as was happening in the US. So there was a bit of controversy over that, but the video range slowly rolled out, and over 4 years they released 10 tapes. So Doctor Who at the time had about 130 episodes, and if you do the maths, 130 stories, if you do the maths, if they were releasing 4 in 10 years, it was going to take about 120 years to release all of the tapes. So at the beginning, I wasn't too concerned about collecting the videos because I already had them off air. So you were just paying for stuff that you already had. And, you know, if you buy something regularly, you get into the habit of buying it. So if there was a tape coming out monthly, you know the tape's coming out, you save for it, you budget for it. But when the tapes are coming out, you know, one and then one comes out 8 months later and then one's 2 months after that, then you wait a year for the next one. It isn't an event and it isn't something that collectors really, really enjoy. So we were getting these tapes sort of higgledy-piggledy. And the other thing which sets Doctor Who apart from a lot of other series that got video releases, if you look at Star Trek or a lot of the other science fictions that have been released, you would get the episodes released in order. So you would get season one and then all of season one would come out. Then you would get season two and all of season two would come out. There, and I think anyone who collected the Star Trek tapes, you know, there was that time when they were releasing the end of the Next Generation and they were releasing the beginning of Deep Space Nine, and then, you know, you would get the new improved versions of the original series, and then you would get Voyager. So they were pumping it out. And I remember reading this article where Star Trek Next Generation, Star Trek nears completion as CIC Video Blitz. So we were getting one or two tapes a year and Star Trek were getting like two tapes a month, and I just felt that was a total ripoff. So Star Trek fans out there were probably better served by Paramount, and I think that's probably because Paramount and the US system was set up as a more commercial system to make money, whereas the BBC, who was sort of in the government charter and sort of taking, you know, taxpayers' money and working out what they can sell and what they can't sell, didn't have their act together nearly as much as they could have. The other thing that happened in the UK that the American market didn't have to sort of look out for was the Screen Actors Guild in the UK was super strict on what could be used. So even repeats, you didn't get on UK TV for a long time because they believed that if you repeated a show, it would take work away from actors making new stuff. So I think the rule was you could repeat a show once in the first 18 months of when it was broadcast. And then after that, you had to renegotiate, which usually meant paying all the actors and all the production staff what they were originally paid to make it. So the BBC were never going to repeat stuff because they'd rather make new things than pay that much money to show old stuff. But then because videos obviously became so commercial, all of that changed. And suddenly the pricing came down, the release rate upped. So you were getting, I think, two videos every 2 months. And because it was not coming out in order, they would skip all over the Doctors, which, if you're a collector, that can be a good or a bad thing. If you're releasing stuff in order, you kind of know what's coming and you have an idea of where the series is going. With Doctor Who, though, if you are a fan of the Seventh Doctor and they release everything in order, you're going to be waiting 5 years before even longer before you see any of the episodes you want. So the marketing really changed where they were now sort of releasing what would probably be at the time considered a classic, so something from the 60s or the 70s, and then they would pair it up with a release from the 80s, so more people were kind of pleased by what they were releasing. And this is where, you know, you had to start to have deep pockets because videos weren't cheap. And I was collecting in Australia, and the Australian releases were notorious as not being in good condition as the BBC English releases, so you'd have to either import them from overseas or get them from one of the bookshops that was importing them, like Minotaur Books or Alternate Worlds, and some of the prices when you bought them from those places weren't so cheap, but you paid for the quality and you paid for getting them sooner than the local releases, and you paid for you got what you paid for, a lot of them as well, which is ironic. I didn't even watch because the things that the off-air recordings were often in a lot better quality than the BBC recordings. So the ones that I was particularly interested in were the 60s, because we got repeats of the 70s show all through the 80s and 90s in Australia, but it was very rare for the ABC to show black and white episodes. So for me, when a black and white episode was released, that was the best thing, because they went around the trading, the tape trading, the old black and whites, but like the audio tapes, you often couldn't see what was happening, or the top of the screen would drift, or the audio would be so bad. So when the official release of those ones came through, they were a real treat. So if we go to the next slide, something incredible happened in about 1992. The video that had been voted the most wanted to be released by the fans was actually found. So one of the things about Doctor Who that some of the people watching might not know, not every episode of Doctor Who exists. The BBC didn't have a policy for archiving things. So in the 70s, basically because they ran out of room, they junked a lot of the episodes. So at one stage, most of the black and white episodes didn't exist. They searched overseas archives when they realised it probably wasn't a good thing to erase all these episodes. And it came down to, in the 80s, there was about 120 episodes missing. And at the moment, I think there's 96 episodes of Doctor Who missing. But the one thing that everyone regretted was Tomb of the Cybermen was missing, which was at the time probably considered the pinnacle of Doctor Who, sort of the best episode that was made up to that point. And it was gone. And then in 1982, first I heard a rumour Tomb of the Cybermen had been found, which didn't really make me bat an eyelid, because at that time every month there was a new rumor of what had been found. Power of the Daleks was back, Evil of the Daleks was back, Tomb of the Cybermen was back. Now, with rumors these days, you can pretty much be confirmed straight away, because the internet news is instantaneous. So you'll get like a rumor, and within a couple of days, you know it's not true, or the BBC will report, yes, these things have been found. Back then, I heard that Tomb had been found, and it took about 2 months to actually confirm it. So I heard it, everyone believed it. The BBC didn't confirm it, of course, because I think they wanted it to come back from Hong Kong and then for them to actually hold the episodes to make sure it was true. But when it did come back, the burning question was, how can you view these episodes? This is meant to be the best episode, best story of Doctor Who, or one of the best ones ever. Where were you going to see it? And at the time, I got a lot of stuff from the UK from a outfit run by John Fitton. And a lot of fans remember him fondly because he was one of the first dealers of Doctor Who merchandise. He dealt in secondhand merchandise, and he also had new merchandise and spread out from Doctor Who to other things like Star Trek. But John Fitton was a saviour when Tomb of the Cybermen was found, because he realised that there was fans all over the world that would want to see this and not wait for the local release. So he put a special ad up that if you pre-ordered Tomb of the Cybermen with him, he would rush. I think he would get it a couple of days before release, because big retailers did, and then he would send it express, rush release worldwide. So that was like the coolest thing I'd ever heard, and I probably think he sold thousands and thousands of units off of that. So I ordered Tomb of the Cybermen through John Fitton. I think I got it 5 days after it was released, which was incredible. I had a viewing party at my house with Doctor Who fan friends and a couple of sort of non-fan friends who were interested to see what all the fuss was about. And I remember watching it, thinking it was the greatest thing ever, rewinding it, watching the whole thing again. I think everyone stayed and watched it twice, and then wanting to rewind it and watch it again, and my mum kicking everyone out of the house going, "That's enough. That's enough, Doctor Who. We're not watching it anymore." This was held up as the pinnacle of old 60s Doctor Who. Was it the best episode of Doctor Who ever? Well, I guess opinions are subjective, but I found a review at the time in Sonic Screwdriver, which is the local Doctor Who fanzine, and Phil here is the president of the club at the moment. And And they, let's see.
Read the magazine while we're all watching you read the magazine.
So, okay, well, like if you go to the, I think there's the frame of it we've got there of the review of Tomb. I think it's no. The next one.
No, the next one was the surprise that you wanted to show.
Oh, if you go back one then.
Okay, hang on. Give me a second. I just want to make sure I don't. Here we go.
Oh, no. Anyway, I haven't got it there. I must have not sent it to you, and I've picked up the wrong episode of Sonic. It's the one where they announce it, not the reviews. But my review was, yes, it was pretty good. Oh, yeah, there you go. So, yeah, that was my review of the time, saying Tomb of the Cybermen did hold up to fan expectations, and it was interesting because now episodes of every black and white Cyberman story existed. Some people were let down by Tomb of the Cybermen when it was released, but if you watch it in context to what else existed in the black and white range at the time, where you've got the Crotons and the Dominators and some of those shows, Tomb of the Cybermen is head and shoulders above that. Since then, the BBC have found more episodes, and some of those I think are just as good as Tomb of the Cybermen. It does surprise me that the BBC did seem to erase the best episodes from the back catalogue, which is I guess Murphy's Law. So Tomb of the Cybermen came back, and for me that was probably, out of all the years of video collecting, the greatest event of BBC video, that they got Tomb of the Cybermen and they rush released it. Was it a success? It absolutely was. They hoped they would sell 30,000 units over a year. They sold 24,000 units the first 4 days. It knocked Alien Special Edition off the sell-through number one, which is quite an event for Doctor Who. And we've got a little clip here to show, which shows you the kind of quality you were looking at.
Is it? I think it's their leader, their controller, Jamie.
So gripping stuff. That's the Cybermen coming out of their tombs. The BBC had said if the Tomb of the Cybermen was a success, they would set up a missing episode office within BBC Enterprises to scour the world for missing episodes. That kind of all went quiet, but I did find in doing some research in fanzines that they did do it, and apparently the office was open for 18 months and they didn't find a thing. So Tomb of the Cybermen funded a worldwide search at the time, and they didn't find anything else during that search. So Tomb of the Cybermen came out, and it was the first Doctor Who that they put Macrovision on, which is maybe one of the reasons it sold so well. There's my little joke there for Doctor Who fans, Macrovision. Macrovision is a signal that's a process that's put on videotapes that mean that it's impossible. Well, it's meant to be impossible to pirate. I had a beta machine that if you tried to pirate something with Macrovision, the beta machine would just copy the Macrovision too. So you'd have a perfect copy, but your beta copy, you'd have Macrovision on it as well. So after Tomb of the Cybermen was such a big success, what they classed, I guess, as the more special video releases from that point had Macrovision. Although, really interestingly, I've got different versions of Tomb of the Cybermen, and some of them have Macrovision and some of them don't. So I don't know if it was a hit or miss process, or some of the runs had it on and some of them didn't. I do know that Macrovision is a separate company that actually sells the technology, or sold the technology to video companies so they could put it on their tapes.
Yeah, just going to butt in here. You're right. Anybody who was involved in making music video clips back in the day, Macrovision was an ultimate pain in the ass trying to deal with it. You could barely get maybe 1 or 2 seconds of tape foot copied before the thing would cut out. And people out there who used to run off copies and dubs for people will know all about it. But apparently older VCRs could bypass Macrovision, whereas the modern ones wouldn't. But,
that might have been what I had with the with our old Beta machine, which sort of, like, they say that Beta was better.
Hmm.
And I actually found that it was. One of the things that was interesting with the Beta, you would have tapes and they had drift across the top. Sometimes when you copied, every time you copied a tape, it would go down a generation. But sometimes when I copied VHS to Beta, the Beta would straighten the top out. And there was a couple of videos I had, you know, you'd get a rare tape off a friend and the colour might just be hanging on there. So the VHS, it'd almost be black and white. Mm-hmm. And I put it onto Beta and it would recover more colour than was on the original tape, which was interesting. So I always found Beta was better, but it just didn't survive against VHS.
Yeah.
So after Tomb of the Cybermen, how could you beat that? Like, Tomb of the Cybermen was one of those releases that it'd be very hard to beat. Well, the BBC came out and released Sharda. The story behind Sharda is in season 17 of Doctor Who, it was kind of plagued with strikes. Not just the BBC, but a lot of things in the UK weren't going well at the time. But the BBC was hit with a strike that meant a lot of shows were halted and they didn't complete their seasons. And Sharda was the last season, the last story of season 17. And it was a special story because a lot of it was filmed on location. So it looked better than a lot of the studio stories. And it was also written by Douglas Adams, who was the script editor of Doctor Who at the time. And he was just about to break the big time with Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy. And Sharda was probably about one third completed. So the earlier episodes are pretty complete and you can tell what's going on. And then the later episodes, there's sort of filming blocks from here and there. So a lot of it wasn't there. So the earlier episodes look great. And then the later episodes just didn't get filmed. And Sharda is an interesting release because it probably wasn't meant to be released. Douglas Adams tells a story that he only knew that it was released when he was at a signing for a book and someone came up and gave him the Sharda video and he was like, well, this isn't meant to be released. And he got onto his agent and his agent said, well, I sent you all the paperwork and you signed it. So Douglas Adams obviously got all this paperwork and just signed. Sent it back and didn't realise what he was actually signing. So Sharda was a video that came with a book, the script of Sharda, so fans could watch it and then they could fill in the rest by reading the book. And also they got Tom Baker to come back and do narrations to fill in the gaps of what wasn't actually filmed. So Sharda was the first time they released anything that wasn't originally broadcast. They did then release later the pilot episode, which was Unearthly Child, but the version that didn't air. So Sharda was a bit of a special release. And then the next screen we've got is Silver Nemesis, which was another special release because it jumped on the bandwagon that was happening at the time where movies and directors were releasing special editions. So they were putting footage back into movies and productions that weren't in the cinema or wasn't finished. And this was the first one that the BBC did. And this was Silver Nemesis, which was the 25th anniversary story of the show. And you can tell it's special because they printed it on, you can kind of see on foil chrome paper. And it was a very rudimentary sort of reconstruction. I think the editors had instructions that they could put stuff back in, but they could only put full scenes and they could only put stuff that wouldn't interrupt the flow of the music because there was no budget to record new music for the extra scenes, or there wasn't the technology to sort of edit in to the middle of scenes new stuff without the flow jumping about. So the BBC jumped on to the special edition bandwagon, and that's a bit of a special tape because even when they released the DVDs, which kind of cover everything that was on the video releases, they didn't put that version on the DVD, and then some of the deleted scenes they didn't put on the DVD. So that's one of the few videotapes that if you're a completist, you kind of need, because it's got stuff on that wasn't released on video. There are a couple of other special editions. They're all from later in the show. Curse of Fenric was another one, and I think Battlefield, and now the DVD and Blu-ray releases, pretty much any extra footage they can find, they shove back in and do different versions, because now there's the room to do them. So Doctor Who did do that, and this is another one of the innovations that Doctor Who did. Now, you can see on the spines of those VHS, they've got a little paintbrush, and the little paintbrush means they've been colour recovered. Now this isn't colourised. A lot of the 70s tapes were sold in black and white to countries that hadn't updated to colour yet. And some of the 70s episodes were wiped, the original colour masters, and the only episodes that existed were the black and white transmission film from overseas. And the restoration team, which is sort of a unique team of fans that work in the industry, got together to work out a way to recolorize them. And what they ended up doing is combining off-air color recordings with the black and white masters, because apparently the black and white masters is where the detail is, and the color is just the underlay. So you can have a lower resolution color. And you can see this is the fourth one that they did, which is one of the most bizarre video releases ever. You can see in the bottom left corner, it has a rainbow pattern on it. And that's apparently because the guy that taped it off air in America lived near a police station or a fire station. And whenever the some signal was calling the fire station or the police station, it would cause a rainbow band on the recording. And this meant when the video was released, there's a warning on it that the quality is not, you know, your normal quality. And so you'll be watching it, and one scene is psychedelic colour, and then the next scene is black and white, and then some scenes they'll start in colour, fade to black and white, and fade back to colour again. So as Doctor Who fans, I think everyone...
You know, the opening sequence is really psychedelic anyway. If you really wanted to push your buttons, when it's actually happening, you ring up the police station and there's their putting their, you know, calling all cars. And the whole TV will go really trippy, and you go, you know what, that actually looks better, you know, with the TARDIS thing appearing and the logo and all the rest of it. So, and the vanishing point. Yeah.
Well, I just imagine for Doctor Who fans who kind of anticipate the release, they know what it's all about. But can you imagine if I just want to watch a Doctor Who, so you borrow it from the video library, and you're probably punching your machine because it keeps fading from black and white to colour and all of this. So that was probably one of the not so successful releases. They could have probably just released it in black and white. The other thing you can see, the top corner there, it is quite a psychedelic story. I had only seen it in black and white. And it's a very sort of serious and dour story in black and white. And then you see the colour version, and it totally changes the tone of things. So it is interesting how the presentation and the format that things are released do affect how you view the episodes. Ambassadors of Death was one of the last releases. We're jumping back here. This was one of the earliest releases. It was the first William Hartnell episodes released. And I put this in now because... after this, I'm going to show something else. But The Dead Planet was one of those that was a fantastic set of episodes to get your hands on. But fans weren't impressed by the video release. Does anyone know why? It is because they released the second tape with a brown colour instead of black. And as you know, any collector likes to have uniform spines on all of their tapes. So if all the Doctor Who spines have been black to this point, and then they release part two in brown, everyone had a meltdown.
See, that's what I always used to say. There's nothing that a can of spray paint won't fix.
Yes, or downloading your own pictures or cutting them off the back of fanzines to make your own covers. But it really didn't matter, because Doctor Who was a range that took 20 years to complete. And do you think any range is going to stay exactly the same for 20 years? So they had different spines, different logos. The logo on the spine was on a different position, different fonts. Then they do groups of stories that made up a picture on the spine. And some stories they'd, you know, start with a picture or start with a style and then you know, because they don't release the next one in the season till years later. That's totally forgotten about. Here's some of the other sort of videos that were released along the way. There was the Years tapes, which collected single episodes that were orphaned from missing stories, or they had the doctors sitting down watching their episodes and commenting on them, which was kind of a nice thing. Some documentaries and the Canine and Company and the two Dalek movies have had various releases over the years as well, with fantastic covers and some pretty average covers too. So the Doctor Who line went for a very long time. And here are some of the other things, if you were a completist, you could get. You see at the top there, there's Downtime and a couple of other episodes. When the show finished, there was such a demand for the show. Professionals in the industry kept making it. Instead of the Doctor, you had the Professor or the Stranger. Instead of Perry, you had Miss Brown. I think they still called Ace in it, though, so I don't know how they got away with that. And they would go to the original authors and they would say, we want to use the Yeti. Would you let us? And because of the contracts, the way they were set up, the authors actually retained the rights to use these creatures. The BBC often had the visual rights to them. So if you got the Yeti, you'd just have to make it look 10% different from what it was on screen and you could use it. So even though you were getting the Doctor Who videos released, there was this unofficial series of videos that was released as well. So Doctor Who collecting really just went on and on and on. So finally, we get to the final release. The final release was The Reign of Terror and then a couple of other orphaned episodes. The BBC promised that they would release every episode on video so people who started collecting could complete their collection, and they were true to their word. It took them 20 years to get everything out on tape. That's the first one, Revenge of the Cybermen, and that's the last one. So Revenge of the Cybermen came out in 83, the 20th anniversary, and you can see the Who in the last one has a 40 in it because it came out on the 40th anniversary. Now, I can't think of another series of tapes that would take 20 years of collecting for you to collect them all. So to anyone who collected all the Doctor Who videotapes, it really was a massive effort and a lot of money. Now, I have we were asked about the value of tapes now, and I've done some calculations here. If we look at the screen, this is today. If you're looking for tapes today, I just got on the Doctor Who Stuff for Sale on Facebook, and there are plenty of tapes, and most of them are around £2 each. So for the majority of them, there's not a lot of value. You would be getting them for the love of it. I actually still keep them because I love the covers. I love the artwork, and it's just nostalgic for me, but there's not a lot of value. That said, the Revenge of the Cybermen, that original release, you're not going to get on eBay for under about £150, £200. And the Japanese versions are very hard to get. I think I paid about £150 for those as well. But there's not a lot of money in videotapes. I did a quick calculation on what I've spent on Doctor Who videotapes. I probably have spent about 80 blank tapes, and then the early releases, which were expensive, and then the next few were mid-range. Then there's about 100 that were the $29, which was the standard release. And then I'm including the DVDs, because after I bought all the VHS, I went and bought all the DVDs as well. And then the Blu-rays, which they're up to about seven sets. Now, without doubles and without, you know, collections and, you know, getting overseas versions, just a standard one of everything over that probably 30 or 40 years now, $10,299 just on videos. So that's the magic number if you started back in the 80s and you've collected one of everything all the way through.
You can probably work that out per how much per year, per month, per week, and break it right down. You go, 10,000 over 20 years, that's only like probably like 20 bucks a week or something.
Probably not. Yeah, when you put it like that, now you've deflated me, Dags.
There you go.
Doesn't seem as much.
Well, so, guess what? That's actually the end of the presentation, which is absolutely fantastic. There's a round of applause for Mr. Aron on that one. Now, it's actually 9:30, which is officially meant to be our finishing time. But we will stick around for a few more minutes just so we can sort of wrap things up and not just suddenly just end the show and pack up and go home. So there were questions that were being asked. So about you've covered off your value. Did you actually end up getting them all, or are you still missing some in your own collection?
I have one of every tape still, and then some of them I actually kept the covers and have disposed of the tapes because they just take up so much room. So I think I've got a full set of BBC English covers and then probably a full set of Australian tapes, and then some of the tapes in Australia they released on a single tape, and in England they released on a double tape, because for some reason in England you couldn't get tapes that would fit six episodes in, but Australia you could. So in those sort of major variants, I've kept one of each of those as well. And then there are some American covers that are different from the rest of the world, and they just come in cardboard slip sleeves. So I've got some of them, and then some of the other overseas oddities like the Japanese one. So I have quite a big collection. The only thing is it's mostly in the garage. I had to pull the garage out to sort of find half the tapes for this display because they're on the bottom, because they're sort of the last thing I ever get out and use these days. So there was a couple of pictures of my collection. That's about probably half of what I've got stashed away. So I do have a full set, and I don't even have a video player anymore.
Yeah, that's actually a very interesting question to ask people. How many people actually have a VCR still attached and plugged into their television? And I'm one of them, even though I don't play tapes. So Fidel, yes, you're right. It is $10,000 at face value. Is a lot of money. But as I said, if you break it over and spend, you know, obviously he didn't buy like spend $7,000 in the first week and then like $3,000 like 20 years after that, it's all sort of broken up. But yeah, if you're getting it in one hit, you're right. That is a lot of money. And yeah, considering it's videotapes, which as Aron said, a lot of them don't hold value anymore except for intrinsic
The other thing you've got to remember, Fidel, is the price of these tapes has gone up and down over the years, and I buy and sell collections. So my collecting has funded my buying and selling has funded my collection. Some of the tapes, even during the DVD era, were going for a lot of money. A lot of those colorized ones, which sold out and you couldn't get in any other format, suddenly those tapes were going for hundreds of dollars at the time on eBay. But like most things, they hit a peak and they come back down, and then better versions have been released. So you've got to, I always say with collecting, collect what you love, because then it doesn't matter if the price goes up or down, you've got a collection you still love.
I mean, because Doctor Who is still going, there's nothing to say that in years from now that the BBC or whoever re-releases everything from day one right on this high new format, you know, the successor to Blu-ray or whatever else, and people just end up buying them again in the best quality they possibly can. I mean, video, it's very funny. We discussed videotape here tonight, but of course, you could probably count thousands or tens of thousands of Doctor Who videos that are in landfill all over the world because people just threw them out because the picture quality wasn't so flash once high-end TVs with plasma and LCD sort of kicked in. So it's good that Aron's kept them all. But, and you know, from a hobbyist point of view, you can look at it and go, well, that looks absolutely fantastic. But a lot of people would say, I really don't want them because I'd rather have them on DVD, unless, of course, they are episodes that you just can't get in any other format.
Well, the other thing that's really interesting, since the VHS range ended, I think they found about 10 or 11 missing episodes. So one complete story and a couple of odd episodes and a near complete story. If the BBC had done a limited edition of VHS, I'd have bought them just to have that complete.
Well, with that in mind, Phil's asked, have you got any on Laserdisc? Did they even release any on Laserdisc?
I do have Laserdiscs. I've got about half the Laserdiscs. Some of the Laserdiscs are just impossible to find.
I would agree, Thomas, that if they were to re-release it all in the future, there's a chance that they wouldn't do it at all because the old stuff is so old and it would be such a limited market that they would probably say, well, the return on investment wouldn't be there. They'd probably consider for the new series from, was it 2005 up to today or whenever it's going to finish, they may focus on that. So because the show is effectively broken into two bits, the classic and the current, that I wouldn't be surprised if they just the past is in the past and they just leave it there. So, yeah, so it was just a thought to say that knowing how companies like making money off something, and you never know, the future of Doctor Who, 10 years from now, it could be the greatest show in the entire universe again. And they do find, hey, this got such a gigantic market of new fans that they do go bananas and release like the ultimate box set, you know, like 10,000 freaking discs of every single episode, then you probably find that the videos would definitely just disappear off the earth.
So, well, there is a lot of love for the video format, even if people don't use it. I don't know if you saw at JB Hi-Fi, they did a range of classics like Back to the Future and Karate Kid, which were on DVD, but they released them in video clamshells, and they sold out really, really fast. And the other thing is when Guardians of the Galaxy was released, you can't buy stuff on audio tape anymore. But because Star-Lord had, you know, his awesome mix and so many people asked for it, Sony released the awesome mix on audio tape, and it cost more to make than DVDs, but it sold out because everyone was after Star-Lord's awesome mix on tape.
But that's the issue of trends, right? Suddenly today it's the cool thing because the movie had it, right? So they produce it because the movie had it. Oh, we love it. 1 year later, no one gives a rat's ass about it. It's a come, it's forgotten. It was just the gimmick. Actually, that's probably the word I'm looking for. It was just the gimmick, right? And that happens all the time. So when gimmicks occur, there is a huge demand. The prices do go through the roof, and then one day people go, why did I get this? Who cares? The Guardians of the Galaxy is forgotten now. So that I don't think you could class as being an accurate representation of long-term sustainability with something, because it's just sort of like when they did with Back to the Future, they made the self-sealing shoes. They only did that because it was in Back to the Future, and the second movie was set roughly around 2018 or 19 or whatever it was. But they wouldn't have done it any other reason. They just did it because the movie did it, and, of course, it just came and went. So, all right, so let's have a look here. We've got a couple of questions. We're going to have to finish off in a couple of seconds. Are they releasing Doctor Who stories on vinyl? Oh, they are releasing Doctor Who stories on vinyl again. Yeah, vinyl is a different story altogether, and it has made a bit of a comeback, which for someone like me who used to say vinyl forever is a pretty cool thing. Yes, Phil's mentioned that a whole lot of stuff is being released on Blu-ray at the moment. Now, of course, when I said the success of the Blu-ray, there probably won't be a success of the Blu-ray, because that's where streaming comes into it. And I guess if ever all these episodes of Doctor Who get it onto a streaming service, whether it be BritBox or something else, maybe that is the format that everybody will turn
to. It's actually really interesting what you say there, because the Doctor Who Blu-rays are an incredible success, but I think they're an incredible success because they don't release as many of them as they should. All the Doctor Who Blu-rays sell out on pre-order. They cost, you know, between, depending where you get them, 80 to about 120 to get. Even on pre-order, they're reselling on the secondary market for $299. And even though they've reissued some of them, they don't seem to be losing their value, which is quite incredible, because you think Blu-ray, everyone should be able to get it, but they've released them in a way where they've kept the demand high, and they do sell out, and they are a really good investment. Everyone's after them. If you don't get them in JB Hi-Fi the day they come out, you can't get them.
Very good. And just to finish up, both Rob and Joshua have enjoyed the show. So make sure you go to Aaron's Collectible Store on Saturday or any day of the week, and just tell him and go, hey, man, it was absolutely fantastic. So there you go. And if you want to, sorry, what?
And don't bring in your video collections.
How's that? He's been promoting this video collection thing. Somebody's going to say, oh, Aron is definitely going to be wanting my Doctor Who tapes. I mean, they'll sell for $2 each. No problems at all walking with them. Because the thing is, if you said you've got hundreds and hundreds of tapes, the amount, the weight, just the weight of all the plastic, oh, my God, you can melt it down and actually build a couple of seats that go into parks and that sort of stuff, park benches.
I have got a couple of the rare tapes in here that I will keep for a couple of days. So if anyone does want to check them out, they can come in and check them out. But then they're going back to my garage.
Much to his wife's joy, I can assure you of that. All right, we're going to wrap this up. I think we've covered off just about everything. Now, we can actually tell you what we're going to be discussing next week. We're actually going to be discussing all the shops and the stores that we used to go into to buy collectibles. So there's a long history, but everybody bought something from somewhere, and we actually think that maybe in years from now, if not even like next week, people will say, I bought the most awesomest thing in the universe from Aron's Collectibles. So that's what we're trying to achieve. We're trying to put Aron on the map as being one of the coolest, if not the coolest, collectible shops in the universe. Any final words before we wrap up, Mr. Aron?
Well, like I said last time, always remember to rewind your videotapes.
Very good. And as I like to say, make sure you keep all your collectibles mint in box.
Or rip it off the card.